Policies. To Hong Kong now, where stocks gained as investors hunted for bargains after a recent sell-off. The Hang Seng Index added 0.2% to end at 25,985 points. The Shanghai Composite Index lost 0.7% to close at 2,933 points, while Japan's Nikkei Index was up 0.3% to close at 22,048 points. The S&P 500 notched its biggest daily gain in 2 weeks last night as investors looked past Democrats' attempt to impeach President Donald Trump, while Nike shares jumped on upbeat quarterly results. The Dow Jones Industrial Average rose 0.6% to end at 26,970 points. The S&P 500, the same margin, closing at 2,984 points. And the Nasdaq Composite added just over 1% to end the day at 8,077 points. Right, so let's get more of the market picture. We cross to Arabile Gumede, who is standing by the Johannesburg Stock Exchange. Lots of green behind you, Arabile. What's moving the markets today?
Yeah, a lot happening certainly, Nzinga. Thank you so much for that time again. As we've just spoken to the CEO of Capitec, of course, the banking stocks themselves have certainly headed a whole lot higher too. As you can tell, that's also come through from international markets. The likes of Asia have certainly performed a whole lot better, as you made note of there as well. And you are getting a sense then that things are filtering through. The decision then by the labor courts to deem the strike by the banking sector tomorrow unlawful has certainly also moved the tiller a little bit then today, seeing the banking stocks taking in that positivity. All of them, including Nedbank, Standard Bank, are all headed higher. So clearly meaning a little bit for those financial counters. What has clearly been evident, though, is that there seems to be some stability coming back to the market in that oil price as well. Saudi Arabia saying that they've restored full capacity in many ways. So certainly it seems like that market is faring a whole lot better. When you take up the European market, well, we'll get to unpack that in just a bit, but for now, here are the numbers, and we'll get into the details right after this. Well, Gerbrand Smit from NEFG joining us here as we unpack that market movement just a little bit more. Gerbrand, thank you so much for the time.
Pleasure.
Let's just start off with the conversation. You may have heard just parts of it there with Gerry Fourie, the CEO of Capitec. Yeah. Your thoughts? A good set of earnings by the seams of things in a tough economy.
Yeah, look, I don't know how they do it, but they do it every year, yeah. Every 6 months. It seems like they can almost put a 20% growth figure on headline earnings per share and dividend in the previous 3 to 5 years, and then it's continuing. So they're certainly doing well. They're picking up new clients. I think they added like 200,000 clients a month of late. If you look at the new policy that they started, the funeral policy, they've already sold a million. That's flying as well. So certainly the lower end, lower consumers are certainly buying into the Capitec story, and I think their philosophy and the concept that they're doing, the simplicity that they do it at, is certainly working for them.
Is there a bubble there? And I only ask, it's only seemed to have headed in one direction. Yeah. At some point you have to call it. Although, that's the same thing we said about Naspers, and look at where that is.
Look what I think they're doing, right? I think there is a bit of a bubble on the short-term lending side business, which they started out at being good at. But they're certainly moving more towards transactional banking, and they certainly, if you look at the revenue and the income streams, it's certainly tilting towards more transactional banking away from the traditional small loans that has high interest rates, etc. I think they certainly killed the market on that front, and I think the consumer were not benefiting on that front. But I think they're transitioning it nicely into a transactional bank, and that might probably see the bubble disappear over time.
Well, then they've worked it out really nicely then in that sense, right? To gain 200,000 consumers though every month is a difficult feat at a time when South Africa is slowing. What gap do you feel like consumers are sort of feeling like this fulfills for them, whether it be a primary account or a secondary account that they're getting with Capitec?
Yeah, look, it's going to be interesting because they've already got 12 million customers and we've got about 50 million people in South Africa. I think it's probably the most in the market at the moment.
Yeah.
If it's being the primary banking account, I don't think so. What they're doing right is they're paying people interest as well. So a lot of people are having a Capitec account just to receive some interest where they don't get it at some of the other banks when having money in their credit cards or check accounts, etc. So I think they're using it as secondary accounts, and then they also don't have the reward system that some of the other banks do have.
Yes.
If you use those correctly for the ISM guys, they're making more money than what the bank costs themselves.
Sure.
At the end of the day. But I think there's a huge market still for Capitec to capture over time. I think they can probably push those numbers higher. There is some competition as well. We know Time Bank is there in that specific market, and they're also paying decent interest on deposits, etc. So let's see what they can do.
And I mean, they're also in a market where they're actually increasing the number of branches they're going to have. They say they're going to raise it to about have another 20 before the end of this year alone. And I mean, that's a massive feat in an economy that's struggling. We're seeing all the banking stocks go up now. But of course, the fight was against a whole lot of people being retrenched from the banking sector.
Yeah.
That digitization and technology was taking over. Do you feel like there is perhaps a fear in that banking sector that things could be really shifting and turning around and the old guard needs to look out?
I think they're already doing that, and that's why they need to get their branches less. And remember that the big four already had lots of established bank branches, etc., over the whole country. And I think they're just in a different stage of where they are in their business cycle. They probably downsizing, and Capitec still need to catch up because they've got lots of clients and they don't have enough branches yet. So it's just a different business cycle and stage where they probably are at the moment.
All right. Overall, take a look at the market picture. We've seen some positivity filter through now. Yes, there may be talks out in Asia and the United States, but those don't seem to be headed in the most positive direction themselves. But we're getting the sense of positivity now after, what's it, about 4 or 5 days odd of negativity as well in the JSE.
Yeah.
Where's that sort of coming from?
I think we had a decent month. We had a lot of sell-offs over the last 2 to 3 months. We had a bit of a decent month, and it collapsed in 2 days of Monday and then Wednesday yesterday. But it looks like they want to do a bit of a catch-up before month end and at least get it some positiveness from that side.
Mm.
But certainly, some of the shares are just rock bottom. They're cheap. Some of these things must be a buy at these levels.
Yeah.
Hopefully people do start cashing in some of these shares that's been cheap, some of the local SA Inc. shares, and hopefully we'll have a better Christmas.
Yeah, well, that will certainly help consumers, that's for sure. And then that oil price as well, as I mentioned a little bit earlier, the Saudis saying they've got full production back online.
Yeah.
Does that help the market in terms of stability to say, it was just a blip? But if it does happen again, surely the fears come back to the market and you start trading at a premium.
I think there's a little bit of a premium still left in the market. I think it's about $2 that's still left in the oil price from when the drones actually did attack and so forth. So I think it was $60 when that happened, or 59. It's now at 62. So I think what you will see in the future, you'll probably have a bit of a risk premium again on oil. If it's only $2, then it's $2. But long-term wise, it's still very cheap at $60 or $62. Doesn't matter so much.
And that currency then, 14.97 now. I think a lot of that could be on the back of course, the positive data coming through from the labor court ruling with regards to the banking strike. How much is the rand sort of steady in and around these levels, do you think?
Now, look, I think it's on the weak side. It was 15.50 a while back. It's now 15 rand. Not long ago, it was 14.50. And if you look a year back, it was probably 13 rand for a dollar. I think it'll probably go back to about 13.50. That's where the PPP is long-term wise. We never know where the currency is going, so we don't try to make money on it. But I think the correct one that we use in our models is probably around 13.50, where neutral is. Can go stronger to 12.50 if it wants to, and it can be as weak as 15.50 where it was just a few days ago.
We just need to stop scoring those own goals. Can you imagine a better rand at around 13.50, oil going back to 59.60 odd?
Then you're
going to
have inflation down, you're going to have interest rate cuts on the horizon.
Oh my goodness.
Consumers will smile.
This is what I'm doing right now, that's for sure. Gerbrand, thank you so much for the time.
My pleasure.
Really, really appreciate it. Gerbrand Smit from NEFG here as we unpack that market movement. Yeah, some positivity filtering through into that market picture. We certainly do hope that even if it is by the end of the year, we get the Rand still trading at around 14.50 odd. It's 14.97 now against that US dollar. Positivity for the JSE All Share as well, nearly 1% higher as we get into this midday trading. That is all we have time for here at the Johannesburg Stock Exchange. And of course, that's where the buck stops. It's back to my colleague in Zing.